I'll tell you a story. This is a mountain called Chicon. Chicon is a mountain 18,000 feet that no one had ever climbed before. So my best buddy in college, a cowboy named Cowboy Steve McAndrews, by the way, being from Jersey, my nickname growing up as a small, short, round child was Puffy. Puffy the Marshmallow Child. So Puffy the Marshmallow Child and McAndrews, Cowboy, are off in Peru climbing this peak. Now you have to understand, to climb these mountains, you gotta have the right stuff. You gotta have these ice axes that you jam these ice axes in the ice, and you have these things on your feet called crampons with points on the end, and you kick those guys in there, and you can climb a seemingly impossible mountain like this. But at about 17,000 of the 18,000 feet, I begin to feel my ice axes sliding through the ice like knives through warm butter, and I find myself falling backward through space. Somebody asked me last week, what passes before your eyes in this moment? Is it your life? The answer is no, it's your lunch. Just so you'll know. This is the truth of climbing. The same guy asked me, he had taken a climbing course. He said, my instructor told me that when you're falling, you must alert your partner and yell, I'm falling! What do you yell? You yell, ah! You know? Which actually conveys the same information with a heightened sense of urgency, right? And then what happens is, as you fall, you feel the rope go snug, and you bounce against the ice, and you feel tremendous pain. You go, great, I'm feeling pain, I'm not dead yet, you know? And then you hear McAndrews yell down, are y'all right down there, J-F? Because Jeff has two syllables in Texas, which always amazes me. I yell back, I'm fine, but because the rope is now, well, I'm hanging from the rope by my nether parts, put it that way. So it comes out, I'm fine, yeah. Well, let me tell you the truth. I get back on the ice. I get to where McAndrews is. Now, this is my best buddy. And I realize I've come that close to death. He's right there. Week before that, we had been climbing in Bolivia. We had stopped for lunch. We had taken off our crampons. We're eating salami sandwiches. I feel myself skidding to the very edge of the precipice. My toes are over the edge. I feel the rope go snug at my waist. I look behind me. There's McAndrews, one hand on the rope, one hand on his salami sandwich, you know? Smiling, I look in those eyes of my best friend, I realize, wow, I'm that close to death, he's right there. Week before that, we're kayaking in a river called the Biobío in Chile, I'm held under by a washing machine wave, I'm not coming back up. And then I feel this hand pulling me, I find air, I find light, I find life, again, that close to death, I look in the eyes of my best buddy, I'm that close to death, he's right there. So on this mountain, on that day, as I get back up to him, I look in his eyes, I realize one very important thing, that my best buddy is probably really bad luck. That's why you climb, because you learn things you wouldn't otherwise discover. Anyway, make the summit of the mountain. McAndrews is a far better climber than I'll ever be. Takes off his goggles, 18,000 feet. The sun's behind the clouds. You don't do that even at 18,000 feet and the sun's behind the clouds because the UV rays are so strong, they start to toast your eyeballs and you start to go snowblind. On the way down, McAndrews cannot see. We're not going to make it down. But locally, we find a Motel 6. Now, Motel 6 is a big old gaping, blue, deep mouth of ice, about 6 foot deep, that you hunker in there, and you wait till morning to see if you freeze-dried or not. In the morning, we are still alive. We climb out of this crevasse. We make it down to the bottom of the mountain. Here's the image. I got McAndrews around the waist, because he can't see. And he's got me around the waist, because the day after your fall, that's when you stiffen, you get all tight, and you can't hardly walk. So we're walking down the mountain like this, and these two little Peruvian kids dare to approach. And I say dare because they'd never seen a two-headed extraterrestrial before, you know? And they're leading their little llama along and they're looking at us and the little kid says, amigo, ¿de dónde vienen ustedes? Where are you guys coming from? And we're machos, so we say, arriba, chiquito, arriba, you know? And then the kid looks at me and he says the words that alter my perspective on life forever. He looks at me and he says, ¿por qué? Which means what? Why? And then he turns to his friend and said, ellos no saben.
They don't know.
No hay nada arriba.
There's nothing up there.
Great. Well, you get the point of the story, you know. And the reason I tell the story is when it's real and I'm not the hero. And two, because it's the most important story I know. I spend lots of time now hanging out with some very impressive, very successful people. And these are not the happiest people you're going to meet. And the reason is this. That very often it seems they've sold everything of value in their lives, their health, the time with their families, all the stuff that really mattered to get to the top of the mountain to discover finally there's nothing up there. I think that we were sold a bill of goods in the 60s when they told us that life was a journey, not a destination, because I think even that gives us the idea there's something at the end of it. I'm discovering at my late age that life is not even a journey. It's really just a crazy, wacky song that we get to hum or sing or dance. And the real way to be successful and to make the mountaintop is never to forget that there's nothing up there. That where it is in the moment. And if your moments are chock full of life, and if you delight in the crystalline beauty of the mountain, and the camaraderie of your friends, and the strengthening and the sturdifying of your limbs when you make the summit, it's as good as every place else in the world that you've been, but that much better, because you got there with a sense of aliveness that you'll never lose.